Now, there was a large show of hands when the question was asked, are you interested in hypnotherapy? Perhaps unsurprisingly for a conference like this. If you've been into it for a while, then I'm sure you've come across the work of Milton Erickson. And I hope some of you have come across the work of Ernest Rossi, who kind of collected Erickson's papers and audio tapes and turned them into something, you know, that was kind of easier to consume. He's written some incredible books and kind of took what I used to call ideomotor work to a kind of new level. It's of great interest to me. It's something I've been using in therapy for years, even though I'm, you know, kind of asking questions at times about, you know, what exactly is happening and how much of that response is suggested. Our next speaker has studied with Ernest Rossi extensively in many different countries of the world over a long period of time. He's got 30 years experience as a hypnotherapist and has kind of taken Rossi's ideas and others, I would imagine, and developed his own exquisite approach to accessing what's often called non-conscious information or unconscious information. So it gives me great pleasure. This is the talk that I've been really looking forward to the most. It gives me great pleasure to introduce him. We're really lucky to have him here. He's traveled a long way to be here, so I want you to show your appreciation and listen real close to Norman Vaughton, everybody.
Thank you. How can I be anything other than an anticlimax after that? Thank you. Right, how many people here have actually worked with Ernest Rossi, studied with Ernest Rossi? No one, thank goodness. I was going to suggest that they left now. Great. Right, as Anthony said, Ernie Rossi was one of the young therapists who sat at the feet of the great Milton Erickson and absorbed osmotically the wisdom of Erickson. Ernie Rossi, more than any of the others, I think, has moved on and has developed Erickson's ideas and has taken them quantum leaps ahead. And some of the most interesting work that he has developed is, I think, his ideodynamic work. Everyone here, I assume, is familiar with ideomotor responses. Yes, no, don't know. So in other words, a very simple vocabulary is possible with idiomotor responses. You usually have not much more vocabulary than yes, no, don't know, maybe a few other things. What I'd like to do this afternoon is to do a series of demonstrations, starting with something very simple and very basic, and then working with volunteers from you to do some more elaborate and more complex pieces of work to show you something of the potential of ideomotor work. Start off with a couple of proposals to you. First of all, movements have meaning. In other words, they are not random, as say the movements of leaves on a tree or a branch blowing in the wind. When a human being makes a movement, it carries meaning. You just did that. Now you've just nodded your head and given a little grin. And
it's fear.
It's fear. And you made a little movement with your hand, and you've just moved your legs outward slightly. So can you go back and remember what that movement meant?
I did that just because it made the fight easier.
So, and then you nodded your head. Did you consciously, deliberately nod your head? Did you think, I will nod my head at Norman now? Or did it just happen?
I think it happened on its own, but
it just happened. And your left hand just went in agreement with what you were saying. So what did that movement?
That was automatic.
It was automatic. And what did that movement mean? Just repeat it.
I think it just means, well, I'm agreeing again.
So that was a non-verbal way of saying, I'm in agreement. And when you shrugged your head and you went pink in the face and you grinned and you tensed up your shoulders, that was...
Oh, please, not me.
And did you think, I'm going to go red in the face now and grin at him and you just shaked your head now? Did you think, I'll shake my head at him now? Or did it just happen? It just happened. You see, never sit in the front row. You should know that by now. Or else you get into these oh no, not me situations. 99% of the movement. What's that hand doing up there now? Who put that there? You just get control of yourself, Norman. And now I'm making these little movements. 99% of the movements we make unconsciously. Where's Adam, who was talking earlier? There. We make non-consciously. Now, I'm not going for a dualistic feeling that there's a part of the brain which is conscious and there's another part of the brain that is unconscious. As far as I'm concerned, when I say non-conscious, I mean stuff that is not conscious. So that is my definition. If you do something consciously, then it's conscious. If it just happens, or you do it without realizing you're doing it, then it is non-conscious. Unconscious is a very uncomfortable word because, you know, it can mean when I've drunk too much liquor, or it could be when someone's just hit me rather painfully over the head, and I've been rendered unconscious. Or it could be a more Ericksonian definition of the word, or a Freudian, and so on. It is a word that we therapists are very uncomfortable with. So I'm talking about non-conscious information, non-conscious processes. When I'm talking about now, 99% of what we say is conscious. I drop something on my foot and I say, oh, shh, or words to that effect, and it just comes out. Some people talk in their sleep, and that is unconscious verbal communication. Who is this Eileen you keep talking to in your dreams? That is non-conscious information. That is information that is coming out verbally and unconsciously. The vast majority of what we say is conscious. Now, as far as I'm concerned, the big beauty of using movement hypnotically is that it is a window into non-conscious information. It's a way of getting into non-conscious information. When you ask someone a question verbally and they're in trance, they can answer you, and they can answer you verbally, but very often they have a difficulty and they say, did I just say that consciously or was that unconscious information? And it's difficult for them and it's difficult for you to distinguish it. With movement, it is much easier to distinguish between conscious and non-conscious information. I'd like to start off by doing a very, very simple demonstration using the implied directive, which you will see on what, so don't look at the other side of the sheet yet. The implied directive after Rossi. How many people are familiar with this as a formula, as it were? Not good. The implied directive, that's a very American phrase. I never understand American phrases. I call it the 1-2-3 formula. A time-binding induction, as, when, if, as soon as, only when, not before. Second part, an unconscious process, unconscious search, unconscious response. Your unconscious does so-and-so. Behavioral response. So this is a way of, in one of the videos that Steve showed, you heard him using this formula, as your hand lifts. Now, this 1-2-3 doesn't necessarily go in a 1-2-3 order. It can go 1-2-3, it can go 3-2-1, it can go 2-3-1, it can go 2-1-3, etc., etc. As your hand sinks down, one, three. What is three? Your hand sinks down. So you'll be going deeper and deeper into trance, non-conscious process. And as, one, you go deeper and deeper into trance, three, so you'll find yourself becoming more and more relaxed. Three, and your eyes wanting to close. Three. Okay? This is a very, very useful verbal technique to have for all sorts of work. So this is the reason why I want to introduce this to you right at the beginning. As a very, very useful technique. One of Ernie Rossi's big discoveries, big things, is the Ultradian cycle, we're all familiar with the circadian or diurnal cycle of where we go into we wake up and then we go to sleep and then we wake up and we go to sleep. The ultradian cycle is superimposed on this. And it has a wavelength of about an hour and a half, something like that. And we go through a series of these ultradian ups and downs through the day, with a particularly big one when people want to yawn. Sorry, I'm being nasty. After lunch. This is the postprandial ultradian dip. And this is the reason why lecturers dread being told you're on at 1:15, because they know that their audience is going to go off into a ultradian dip. I'm going to facilitate that for you now. I'm going to allow you to do that with full authority. So if you like to put your pieces of paper down, and what I'd like you to do is to hold your thumb up in front of you and focus your attention on it and notice the slight movement that it inevitably is making. Maybe upwards, maybe down, maybe a slight vibrating. Just focus absolutely on your thumb. And maybe from one side to the other. And I want you to give yourself the suggestion that as that thumb is slowly sinking downwards into your lap, so you'll be able to go into a really deep, very, very pleasant state of relaxation, inner focus, inner peace. At a certain point, you'll probably find it becomes easier just to let your eyes close. And when that happens, you can allow that to happen. And that hand will be sinking down no faster than you can go into what for you will be a really useful, productive, ultradian dip, a time of renewal, of relaxation, of restoring, a time of inner quiet, inner focus. And in that state, you will very probably find your own deep unconscious can allow you some very special experience. Maybe a memory or an insight something rather special, just for you. And allowing yourself all the time that you need. And in this hypnotic time, can be as absolutely long as you need to enjoy, to use very constructively for yourself. And only then when there is a sense of real completeness and completion, a sense of readiness to return back into the here and now, will you find yourself wanting to take a longer, deeper breath? And when you're ready to bring everything right back into focus in the here and now, find your eyes wanting to open again. Feeling refreshed, renewed, and looking forward to the next experience that's waiting for us. And if you're still in deep trance, allow yourself to stay there. I will continue talking to the others. But be respectful of yourselves and your own individual readiness. Okay, so what I did there was to chain together a whole series of those implied directives. You probably lost track of them, but you are having a whole series of those 1, 2, 3s, 2, 3, 1s. And when, number one, there's a sense of real completion and completeness, that's the unconscious, you'll find yourself wanting to take a longer, deeper breath. Three. And when you're really ready to bring everything right back into focus in the here and now, find your eyes wanting to open, etc., etc. It's really useful to know where your client is at. Now, doing a group piece of work like that is always difficult because different people work at different speeds, and therefore I can't pace every one of you. Some people went into trance very very quickly, other people take much longer, etc., etc. If you're working with an individual, you can pace your work with them much more easily, much better. Right, moving on to a more complex piece of work. I am going to ask, hands can express and experience virtually anything that a human being can. People who are deaf have a whole sign language. In ballet, there's, again, a whole language. So if I say to Maggie, what am I saying to you?
You're
I beg your pardon?
You're showing your love for me.
I'm saying I'd like to marry you. I'm saying I swear eternal troth to you. If I do this, I'm saying, you're too modest to say. I'm saying you're very beautiful, etc., etc. So there's a whole language of movement. And sorry, what's your name?
Paul.
With Paul, I now know what this means, which means, oh no, not me again, does it? So, now you see, that's dirty because that's me putting my interpretation on it. But I didn't want him to think that I was forgetting him or anything like that. But the moment I spoke, there was a movement, which is not part of the ballet vocabulary, but is his vocabulary. Okay, I'm going to be working with an individual. The next demonstration I would like to do is quite a useful, I'll be using a basis for it, which is very useful when you are faced with problems of a certain structure. And these are problems which we are frequently confronted with as therapists. They are when you have two parts of a person in conflict with each other, when you have a problem of indecision between one thing and another, when you have a polarity within a person and a conflict between those polarities, etc., etc. Almost anything that can be formulated into the formula of on one hand and on the other hand. On one hand, he really switches me on, and I think he's a fantastic guy, but I know that he's an absolute bastard, and I don't know what to do about it. I've got this really good job, and I hate it. And part of me wants to leave and get the hell out of it and hand in my resignation. Another part of me knows that I'll never get another job as good as this, and I really need to hang on to it. You get the idea. I would like someone in a few minutes, when you've had time to think about it, who is in reality confronting a either or, a decision, a conflict, a one part, another part. And there are so many things that come down to this. There's part of me that really wants to give up smoking. I know it's bad for me. I know it's killing me. I know it's really destroying my health. There's another part of me that loves it and relies on it, and I don't know how I'd cope without it. You get the picture, okay? So that is the sort of thing that I want to work with. You may now, like all good examinations, turn your pieces of paper over. When one's doing a piece of work like... These are processes which one will not necessarily do in this order. But I want you to look out for when I'm doing these things. In other words, he's seeding now. He's producing a levitation now. Okay, so in that last piece of work, I asked you consciously to levitate your hands, to hold your thumbs up there. And I then said, I want you to focus your attention on them. Now, some people did that very successfully immediately, and they fixated their attention. And of course, that is hypnotic in itself. Other people were looking around at what was going on with everyone else. That was not very hypnotic. If I'd been working with them individually, I'd say, no, focus on that. One of the nice things about doing ideodynamic work is that one's got a closed circuit. You're not fixing your attention on some pattern up there on the ceiling or something. You are actually focusing on your own information. This I always think of as information-centered therapy. Rather than client-centered therapy, it's information-centered therapy. You'll see more of that in this next demonstration. Fascination, disassociation. You heard Steve saying, and as that hand lifts. That's disassociated language. As you lift your hand, what is that? That's associated language. I want you to lift your hand. Associated or disassociated? It's associated. I want you. This is my hand. I want you to lift your hand. You are... Who is you that I'm talking to there? Who's the you that I'm talking to? Conscious mind. I'm talking to the conscious mind. I want you, conscious mind, to lift that hand. We started off with that exercise with me saying, I want you to lift your hand up. That's a normal, conscious, associated communication. And notice how that is moving. What have I done? I've slipped into disassociated language. And notice how that, it's no longer, not notice how your thumb is moving. That would be associated. Notice how that is moving. It's become a that, it's become a thing. It's no longer part of me. It is disassociated. Notice how that is moving. It's doing it all by itself. Did you move your feet like that? Or did they just move by themselves?
They're working on their own this time.
And that head's nodding on its own this time. Not letting you off the hook. And as that happens, that's dissociated language, as that sinks down, as that, etc., etc., do you get the idea of it? So I am deliberately using dissociated language because I want to produce a total disassociation so that this person knows I am not moving this. I am not doing it. And you'll find when you're working with a client, you can see very easily the difference between an associated conscious movement and a disassociated movement. Two hands coming together like this. That's disassociated. as those come together like that. I want you to bring your hands together. That's associated. That's a conscious movement. And out of this one gets entrancement. Entrance, going into a trance state. Eye closure will very probably happen spontaneously. Otherwise, you can give a permissive eye closure. And when it becomes easier, you can just let your eyes close. Or else, notice when their eyes are blinking. That's right. Eyes blink. Just let that happen. Don't even have to mention the eyes. Just let that happen. The eyes close. Very elegant. Information gathering. You'll hear me information gathering when I'm doing this demonstration, hopefully. One never knows with a demonstration what's going to happen. Amplification. This is echoing back what a client says. This is, you see some tiny tremulous movement. Yes, notice that. Let that happen. Some people you will find have minuscule movements, and afterwards they will very often feed back. You say your hands looked as if they were scarcely moving. I thought they were moving all over the place. In other words, there can be this hypnotic distortion that they have a sense of a great deal of movement. There are other people who you'll get enormous and extravagant movements with, which are much easier to see and much easier to go with. I had one client who I saw over a period of some years, worked through an enormous amount of stuff with him. He originally presented with pain in his shoulder and went back into all sorts of stuff. An incredibly abusive childhood in the East End of London during the war and so on and so on. And with him, it will be Can I have an Oscar, please? thank you. Woke you all up again out of your ultradian dips. He's a joy to work with. I have tried doing all sorts of other hypnotic work with him. And I will start off today. I'm going to do so-and-so today. And his hand just goes like this, and he's off. And he produces spontaneous levitation. And I know, right, we're doing ideodynamic work again. Processing information with process instructions. In that very tiny piece of work I did with you, there were process instructions there. And you can use this time, blah, blah, blah. Maybe memories, maybe an insight, maybe just deep relaxation, so on. Process instructions. Right, that's as far as I'll go now. Who would like to do a piece of work with a polarity something, an indecision, a conflict, and you don't need to tell us more than a very minimal amount about it. A guinea pig, please. Great, well done. Thank you. Okay, Steve. Anything you'd like to tell me, like to tell us, it's okay to.
Okay.
About the nature of this.
Right. I've recently met somebody. I've had some very powerful and strong feelings of attraction there. They live in another country, so getting to see them is very difficult. And communication can sometimes be difficult. I'm also experiencing a lot of insecurity and anxiety associated with that. And I'm trying to work out whether this is a realistic possibility of sustaining and maintaining this romance.
Right. So we already, those of you who've been watching, have our own fantasies as to which hand might be which. Yeah? So, and I will formulate it into, on the one hand, on the one hand, there's anxiety and uncertainty and the problems of communication. And on the other hand, there's an attraction.
And a very certain sense of some very definite and attractive feelings.
And some very certain sense of attractive feelings, okay. Can you tell me more about the anxiety and the uncertainty? Anything else about that?
Some of it has to do with the fact we're still getting to know each other, so I don't know very much about them, really. And the other part is that because of the distance and the communication, I'm trying to read an awful lot out of not very much exchange.
So that's all on the anxiety side. And on the other side, that's a very personal...
On the other side, I just have these wonderfully, powerfully... affirming feelings when we're together.
Wonderful. Great. Okay, Steve.
Yes, Steve. Shall I swivel around?
Yes, let's swivel around. So, Steve, what I'd like you to... Now, I noticed you... you see, you're sitting in the front row again. When we were doing that other piece of work, had your elbow... resting on the arm piece and your hand didn't go down. Right. Just a practical hint. It's always a good idea if you have someone in an armchair to make sure that their elbows are not resting on the arms, because if they are, it's likely to impede and affect movement. And so on. So we haven't got any problems of arms here. Okay, so what I'd like you to do is just simply focus your attention on those two hands. And I want you to become very, very sensitive. Just see that little pulsing there? And I know you're not doing that deliberately. And there is actually one that's rather different on the other hand. And just allowing any movements like that. There, notice that. And that tensing up there. And when you have a sense of which hand is which, see all that. Do you notice how those are very distinctly non-conscious movements? I will be talking to them from time to time. They're paying for it. I've got to talk to them. Yeah, see that? Just, wow. Isn't that incredible? Yeah, just let that happen. And do you know which hand that is?
Mm.
Which hand is that?
It's my love hand.
That's the love hand. And there's so much more going on in that hand, isn't there? Just look at all that movement there. That's right. Let that happen. Yes, and know about that. Transduction of information. Know about that. Yeah? Wonderful. Yeah. There's so much life in that, is there not? Yes. That's beautiful. Notice the difference in this other hand. What do you notice about that hand?
It's not got much to say for itself.
It hasn't got much to say for itself. Amplification, echoing back the exact words. And it hasn't got much to say for itself. It's even a different, yeah, notice that. What kind of movement is that? Just allow that movement to happen. Be very sensitive to that. And know about what kind of movement that is. Yeah. And those. What are the differences between those two hands that you're noticing? It's more alive, yeah? And what else?
My right hand is searching for something.
And the right hand is searching for something.
Mm.
That's just how it is. And it's searching for something. And what else?
Wanting, searching, seeking, grasping, I guess.
Right. And this hand?
This hand feels a bit stuck.
And it's stuck.
And
it's
it feels quite passive.
And it's stuck, and it's passive. Yeah. And it doesn't know what to do. And it's stuck and it's passive. And it doesn't know what to do. And that hand is seeking and searching and alive and grasping. And when it's like that on the one hand and like that on the other, I'm just wondering what needs to happen, what can happen. And I don't want you to consciously take any part in that. You may want to let your eyes close and just be very aware of the dynamic between those two hands. That's right. And just allowing. Yes, wow. Yeah, and notice how that right hand is turning. And And that will be happening no faster than that can really happen. Yeah. That's it. And as, yes, feel that. Feel that. Yes. And just wondering. Yeah. And this is exploring into such new territory. And it is so important to get that right. Yeah? Yeah? Yes? Yes, feel that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Yes. And just wondering. Possibilities. Potential. Consequences. And allowing those hands to yes, yes, and searching, seeking, wanting. Being very respectful of that other. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. And it does take time. Feel that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And know about that. The insights. The thoughts. There's so much involved. And it is complex. You keep with that, Steve, while I just talk to the others for a moment. Now, hopefully everything that I'm saying is clean. In other words, they're either his words or they are clean suppositions, things like it's complex, it's not easy. There are complex processes going on here. Much more than I or you can ever dream or know about. And these are the process instructions that I'm giving to facilitate this process to continue. This major life decision that's being made. And the decision will not necessarily be brought to fruition or completion in a single session. What one can hope for is that some steps will be taken and there will be some movement towards that. Part of an ongoing process. Wow! Look at that. Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. That's it. That's it. Yes! And as you make that connection, what can happen then? Shift to the subjunctive. We're into the realms of new possibilities. What can happen? That's right. Yes. Yeah. And really experience that. And how, yes. And how different that is. And what needs to happen then? Yeah. Yeah. And knowing all you need to know about that. And maybe decision. Differences. Yeah. And what else needs to happen to really get that right? Yes. Yes. Feel that. Experience that. Mm-hmm. Yes. 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 Wow. Yes. Mm-hmm. Taking all the time that that needs and to really get it right. Mm-hmm. Yes, that's right. And then, yes. Allow that to happen. And really taking that in. Yes. Yes. Yes, and feeling that, experiencing that as that happens. Yes, yes, and know about that, and the feelings and the emotions and the intensity of that. And how profound that is. Making that yours very profoundly, very deeply. Feel of it, the look of it, the very taste of it within you. Yes, yes, and hold on to that. taking time to make that yours through every part of you and every part of every part, through every tiniest cell that has knowing and experiencing, through the whole of your being. And of course you do know this is an ongoing process. It's part of your life. And this process will be continuing in your thinking, your living, your dreams, and in your dreaming. In your life and working out, and in your realizing. Feel that. That's great. And be very respectful of yourself through the rest of this afternoon. So when you've done, good work very deeply. It is important to value, to allow it to set and to settle. Very really and deeply. Taking all the time you need to stay with that, Stephen, and only then. And when there's a sense of real readiness and preparedness to come back and join the rest of us here in this room, you'll find yourself wanting to take that longer, deeper breath and to bring it all right back into focus in the here and now, but keeping it and a firm grasp on that, and holding that there, and valuing it. Wow. Thank you very much. That was a great privilege.
Thank you. You've got a lovely voice. That was really, really interesting process. Really interesting.
Any few words you'd like to say about that process?
Well, I was fascinated at the outset to observe my fingers moving completely spontaneously. I had no conscious influence over that. So I was quite fascinated by that. As I closed my eyes and the process started to evolve, I think some fear and self-consciousness entered into the scene. I think that's because of the setting. And I was trying to get out of my own way, sort of thing. And I went through a bit of a tussle there. But I felt myself engaging with a quality of knowingness about this situation. Again, it's, well, clearly there's quite a lot of it available to consciousness, but no, there was some new insights, and actually qualitative shifts in feeling as well. That was really interesting. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Very much. Thanks so much. I've overshot my time. Normally, I would do a two-day workshop to teach this magic stuff. So if any of you would like to learn more, because I have, there's just so much more and so many more ways of working with it. So if any of you are fascinated and would like some more, talk to Anthony. Get him by the arm and twist it around his back. Great. So thank you all very much. Sorry, I've overshot.
That was wonderful. Thank you very much. Really appreciate that. Okay. How clean was that?